Just before we get into the message this morning, and first of all, let me say this. This is a mini-series on gratitude, and the question is posed, which will also be posed next week. Do you have an attitude of gratitude? But a couple things I want to mention. First of all, whoever did or whoever did the decoration to the sanctuary, thank you. Doesn't the place look lovely this morning? So I thank you all to step up and get a beautiful job. And then the other thing I want to mention is that it's true, next Sunday we are going to be hosting the Evangelical Minister Association Thanksgiving service. What a privilege. But with that privilege comes responsibility. Well over 200 people attend this service from the various churches in our community, and we need to provide refreshments after the service. So if you're bringing desserts next week to our banquet, then just bring extra that we can use that night. Or if you want to help us out in a special way and make something for that night, we would be extremely grateful to you. Now, as I was thinking of this message and knowing some of the areas that we'll be talking about this morning, I recognize that there will be a few points that are going to be like a, ooh, ouch. I realize also I'm not in a good venue to cause oohs and ouches out there, because in some places you can throw tomatoes and eggs or whatever at me, but looking around, all you have is Bibles and hymn books. And needless to say, that's going to hurt. So kind of control yourself this morning as we walk through this particular series on gratitude. And remember, we're talking about having the right attitude and an attitude of showing praise and an attitude of respect to the very one in whom we serve. Psalm 100 we're going to be looking at today, as well as Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 8. The psalm writer writes these words: "Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness continues to each generation." And then the Apostle Paul writes to the church at Philippi and to you and I as we sit in this setting these words: "Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all that you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you'll experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true, and honorable, and right, and pure, and lovely, and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise." There were two men that decided that they wanted to take a shortcut home, so they crossed through a field. Now, the field had all kinds of signs saying no trespassing, but they ignored the signs. They got into the field, and it wasn't soon that they came across the farmer's bull. When the bull saw these two strangers in his field, and I'm sure the bull knew also there was no trespassing signs on the outskirts of the territory, it became raged with fury. It snorted a few times and then took off after these two guys. Now the men began to run to the nearest fence, but soon they discovered they were not going to outrun the bull. So one turned to the other and said, "Pray, Johnny, pray! Pray as hard as you can!" And Johnny's running down as fast as he can with his friend saying, "I don't know how to pray. I've never prayed before." He said, "Well, this is a good time. It's time to learn. Pray for us." And so Johnny says, "I only know one prayer. That's the prayer our father taught us. Oh Lord, for what we're about to receive, make us thankful." Well, I think the hardest arithmetic to master is that which enables us to count our blessings. In fact, over the posts on Facebook that have come my way over this past week, even leading up to the election, and even in the course of other things, it seems to me that America has lost a spirit of gratitude. They don't know how to be thankful. There's concerns about the unemployment rate as it continues to climb, and maybe some of you are sitting right here wondering if you're even going to have a job in the near future. And I don't care who is placed in office, we just haven't seemed to solve our national debt. One congressman said that by the end of this decade, Americans are going to owe personally $300,000 in debt. I wonder if the government accepts MasterCard or Visa. And social ills continue to threaten our way of life, and the faith you and I once had invested in our politicians, that has all vanished and faded away. So we are saying, what is there to be thankful for? And to add to that, we face our own personal struggles, struggles that affect our relationships, our marriage, our health, our friendships, our family, even our future. So if this is what's rumbling through your mind, let me try to put some things in perspective for you this morning. In Plymouth, Massachusetts, the first settlers set aside a day of Thanksgiving. Yet, if you were to read deep enough into the history of that era, you'd recognize they had many hardships they were still encountering. In fact, all that was taking place in their life gave them very little to be thankful for. They should have been a bitter people. After all, did you know that the pilgrims made 7 times more graves than they did homes in which to live? Yet, in 1621, they set aside a day to thank God for his provisions. Isn't that amazing? They still were thankful for all that God was doing in their midst, despite their circumstances. As one person wisely stated, we do not always get what we ask from God, but we always have reason to thank him. And the psalm writer in Psalm 100 gives us a list of 3 reasons why you and I can always be a people of praise and gratitude. First, we can give thanks because God's character is good. The psalmist declared, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is what? Good. Now, hopefully, all of us can draw up a list of reasons why we should thank God and give him praise. It might be our own personal health. It might be our family. It might be freedom. It could be our children. I have 4, and sometimes I'm scratching my head. Or if you are a student, it could be a good grade on a test. However, in Psalm 100, we're asked to give thanks to the Lord simply because he is good. We should honor God first and foremost, not because of what he has done for us, and he has done plenty, we'll be talking about that, but just because of who he is. And let me add this to it, to even encourage your heart all the more. Not only is God good, the Bible says he's also patient and kind, slow to anger, abounding in love. So let us enter his courts with a thankful heart because the character of God is good. But secondly, we can give thanks because God's love endures forever. Now, I have come to this conclusion, and you have perhaps yourself, that we live in a confusing world, don't we? In fact, I don't know about you, but things seem to have been so much simpler years ago. I'm not talking about going back to the good old days at all. I do enjoy the things that are happening today. But you know, years ago, you could spell relief. And it wasn't R-O-L-A-I-D-S either. You actually knew how to relax, how to enjoy a moment. Let me reminisce, if I may. This is where I might get some dirty looks. There was a time in which the girls wore earrings. And the guys were the ones who wore boxer shorts up over their waist underneath their jeans. The word cool referred to the temperature outside, and the word grass, that was something you walked on. Well, we've come to a day and age when those words have all changed. They don't mean what they once did. Take, for instance, the word love. In theory, The meaning of love has not changed. Webster still defines it as this: a strong affection for, or attachment, or devotion to a person or persons. Yet in practice, our definition has radically changed. Whereas love used to embrace the concept of devotion, today it now is more a synonym for pleasure. Years ago, the word love would have meant it was other person-centered. In other words, if I love someone, I would go out of my way for that person. I would do whatever I could to make that person happy. I would sacrifice. I would surrender. There would be nothing or no cost too dear for me if I loved someone. But today it's like, well, if you love me, this is what I expect. Today, love is self-centered. We tend to commit ourselves in relationships as long as it remains convenient to us. But once there is trouble on the horizon, boom, we skedaddle, we're gone. At the first sign of trouble or disagreement, we walk out of there, seeking greener grass on the other side of the fence. A reminder of the pastor who was getting ready to officiate a wedding, and the bride and the groom were before him. And he turned to the groom as they were getting ready to make their vows, and he said, "Do you take this woman to be your wedded wife, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in..." "Oh, stop it right there, pastor," the bride interrupted. "You're going to talk him right out of this." Well, today that word love seems to be defined as a set time, a specific reason, all involving self-interest. Somewhere along the way, we have lost the significance of what love really is. But the songwriter writes this: "Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good, and his love endures forever." God's love is not like the weather. It's not uncertain. It's not one that you can't quite forecast. And it never changes with the seasons. As Richard Havelson noted, there is nothing you can do to make God love you more. And there is nothing you can do to make God love you less. His love is unconditional, impartial, everlasting, infinite, perfect. Amen to that, right? But then there's another concept that the songwriter brings out. Third, we can give thanks because God's faithfulness never ceases. In the book of Lamentations, Jeremiah wrote, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And then in 2 Timothy, Paul declared, "If we are faithless, he will remain faithful, for he cannot disown himself." That's an amazing text. In other words, if we fail, we mess up, if we're not as faithful as we should be, God is still faithful. He cannot go against his own character. And when I think of that, this is what it does for me. When I'm walking through the tribulations of life, I know that my God is there because he promised to be there. I have a good shepherd. I don't need any other shepherd in those moments. When I'm facing difficulties, God is by my side because he says, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." I can hold on to his faithfulness. David learned that lesson when he faced Goliath. Gideon learned that lesson when he faced the Midianites. Paul, when he was in confrontation with King Agrippa. And Stephen even recognized that promise when he was facing an angry crowd that actually took his life. He still knew God was faithful. God would not fail him. In fact, I think in his heart, he had the same expression as the Apostle Paul did years later: "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain." He knew that the faithfulness of God would bring him right into God's presence. There's a legend about a man who stumbled across a barn. In this barn, he discovered, is where Satan kept all the seeds of sin to be sown in human hearts. But he also discovered that the seed of discouragement outweighed all the other seeds in the barn. And so he asked Satan, what is it about this? And Satan says, well, discouragement, being disgruntled, grumbling, complaining, that's a spirit that so easily grows in the soil of the human heart. That seed flourishes. But he says, there is one place that seed will never thrive. And the man asks, well, where is that? In the heart of a grateful person. Isn't that amazing? So let us rejoice because the Lord is good and his love endures forever and that his faithfulness will continue through all generations. But here's the part that you might want to throw a hymn book. Because God is calling us to be grateful people, there are some things we really need to steer away from. First of all, thankful people don't complain. How many find themselves around a lot of complainers? Always grumbling. Now, I'm not talking about not being concerned. I'm not talking about your situation. If it causes you to express some of the concerns you have, you can bring all these things before the Lord. I'm talking about having that grumbling, that complaining spirit about you. You know, just as God hears our compliments, don't you think he also hears our complaints? He knows when we're counting our blessings or when we're envious of our neighbor's blessings. He knows all these things. And every time we actually complain, I'm talking about complain, not just reflecting our health issues or reflecting our concerns, but when we complain about these things in our possessions, our families, our jobs, what we're actually doing is complain that, hey, God, you don't provide well enough. You're not the good father I thought you were. Think of it for a moment, if I can put it in this kind of concept, that you're raising your family, and you're doing everything in your power to provide for them. You have a roof over their head, they have beautiful clothes on their back, they have food to eat, and you're trying to give them the things necessary, and even some of the things that maybe you never had growing up. You're caring for them, you're working extra hours so they can have a great Christmas, a college education, whatever the case may be. And then you discover that once they walk out of your presence, they are bashing you as parents. You're not doing enough for them in their estimation. You're not living up to your end of the deal. You're not giving them everything they want. How would you feel? How appreciative would you be over your unappreciative children? Would you be heartbroken? Knowing that you were trying to do the very best that you could, and when they left the home, it was being thrown in your face. Now, how do you imagine God feels when he's given us his only begotten Son for our salvation? And he's lavished us, not with just what we want, but with all that we need. You guessed it. He's heartbroken. So, my friends, let's be careful not to have a complaining spirit. I've said this, I believe, even in the newsletter, and I've used it before. Every one of us in this room can have a PhD. Every one of us praising him daily. And that's what we need to be doing. Take that and write it down. I have a PhD in the spiritual walk, praising him daily. Matthew Henry, who wrote a commentary in every book of the Bible, was once robbed. I shared this morning that I can relate, I can empathize with Matthew Henry. As I was pastoring in Ellington, Connecticut, our church was broken into, my office was broken into, and everything I had in my office was taken out. I was robbed. The expression of being robbed, the feelings, I guess, of being robbed are hard to define. You've been violated. But 2 years later, when we took our church in Arkansas, after I spent money replacing all the things I lost, guess what? I was robbed again. Somebody broke in the church, broke down my office door, and took my belongings. Now, I have to say, I did not have the same attitude that Matthew Henry had. I complained quite a bit. But I want to read what Matthew Henry wrote the very night in which he was robbed. In his diary, he's written these words. I am thankful that during these years, I have never been robbed before. Also, even though they took my money, they did not take my life. Although they took all I had, it was not much. Finally, I am grateful that it was I who was robbed, not I who lied. Interesting perspective. He had every reason to complain, but remained thankful. The other thought, thankful people do not hoard. How many of you have seen these programs on TV of hoarders? You can't even walk into their homes, it's gotten so bad. Listen to me. The art of hoarding, the art of collecting, is really, in this essence, the art of taking things upon yourself without ever having an interest in sharing. So what that means is the bottom foundation of hoarding is pride. This is my stuff. I'm going to hold on to it. I'm not going to let go. Nobody else is going to get it. That, my friends, will destroy a generous, grateful spirit every time. The humble mind is the soil in which thanksgiving naturally grows. A proud person is seldom a grateful person, for they never think they get as much as they deserve. Let me help you with this. Now, I didn't spend, it's right here in my pocket, sorry about that. I didn't spend any money on this because I was in the next program. This is the iPhone 7. And you folks all know that when it comes to technology, I'm a mess because I have to have the next best thing out there. But how long am I going to be satisfied with the iPhone 7? Until iPhone 8 or iPhone 7S or something else comes out, right? So what is the big deal? I should be content with what I have instead of saying, oh Lord, please help me get an iPhone. I have an iPhone. Man, I'm going to be able to communicate with my church family. I'm going to be able to do the things I want to do. He provides me with an iPhone, and what? 5 months later, oh Lord, please, I need the iPhone 7. I can communicate better with my church family. I can do more work with the iPhone 7. And what happens when the iPhone 8 comes out? Same prayer. Shame on you. Seriously, shame on me. Why would I ever want anything more than what God's provided? He's cared for the needs. And I know some of you guys want my iPhone 7, but I still believe it. Show me a generous person, and I'm going to show you a grateful person. Have you ever met a thankful person who wasn't generous? Again, it's odd, but the more we hold on to things, the more we want. It's not good enough. We need something else that we're still not going to surrender what we're holding on to. The more we give away, the more reasons we find to be thankful. Yesterday, we had our best year's fellowship. After we got done with the food, as Pastor Judy said, some of us came and we put our boxes up here at the platform so you guys could see today all the Christmas child gifts that have come in. Others cleaned up. After everything was done, I took off to town to a local place I go, a cafe, to get something you guys are well familiar with, my Mountain Dew. But as I was in line waiting to get my Mountain Dew at this cafe, there was a special needs individual that was at the counter. And he had a caretaker with him, and he was trying to count out some money. And I could tell as he was counting out his money, he only had some change there, that whatever he was going to get, he definitely didn't have what he needed. So I turned to the caretaker and I said, what's he interested in? The caretaker told me, and to the guy behind the counter, I said, look, I'm going to get a large drink. Get what this man wants as well, which also is a large soda. And let me just add this, it was Mountain Dew he wanted as well. So I'm feeling double blessed. But let me just share, as I was paying for it, he just kept looking at me like, thank you. He kept saying it over again and over again, thank you. But I could tell he had no idea why I was doing it. And tears were beginning to form and roll down his cheeks. All because of a $2 soda. And I'm like, Lord, to be a gracious person surely doesn't take a lot. If we have our eyes open, our ears in tune, you bring people along our side all the time. that we can help out and bless. And the caretaker began to share how thankful he was. And even the guy behind the counter said, you know what? If you didn't do it, I was going to do it. It was just a blessing to all those that were there. In the book of John, Jesus meets a woman by a well. Many of you are familiar with the story. Notice what she does, however, when she receives this wonderful gift of redemption. When she discovers who Jesus is and why he came and that he is the Savior of the world, what does she do? Does she hoard it? No, she runs into her village. She tells everyone what's going on. She gathers a crowd and says, I have met the Messiah. I have met the Redeemer, the one who gives life to those who are dead. Her heart was so thankful she could not contain the news within. So how can we say with our mouths that we're thankful people and not be generous, be hoarders? How can we say in thanksgiving prayer and celebrate even God's bounty in our own homes when we've not reached out a hand to help others in need? How can we fill our own bellies and not give so that other bellies might be filled as well? Can selfish, hoarding people truly be called thankful people? You may argue the point with me, but from my perspective, I thank God. Like the woman at the well, we show our thanksgiving in and through our generosity. When we tell others about the joy of Jesus, when we share God's riches with others, when we're generous with our time and our talent and our money, then we can be called a thankful people. And I'm going to ask the praise team if they come back to the platform now. But finally, thankful people don't forget. There's some things we talked about even weeks ago about our past that God wants us to forget, to get over. But when he blesses us in the past, we should remember those blessings, should we not? Because people that are not thankful are always looking forward, never grasping what God has done in the past. Ask them they want. They're going to tell you. I'm sure all of us already, even before it's Thanksgiving, has a Christmas list. But you ask these same people what they're thankful for, they give you a blank stare and kind of scratch their heads. Too often, gratitude is dependent upon circumstances of life. But I dare say, when you know Jesus Christ, that's not the case. Reinhardt was a minister in Germany during the 30-year war back in the 1600s. In his town, he was the only minister. During that time period, he presided at nearly 4,500 deaths because of the war. And yet, in the midst of this tribulation, he wrote this particular hymn called Now Thank We All Our God. I'm just going to share one little stanza. Now thank we all our God with heart, hands, and voices, who wondrous things has done, in whom his world rejoices. Out of this kind of anguish came praise. Why? Because he was a man grateful for all that God had done. Thankful people don't have to have everything going their way to be thankful and to be praiseworthy. Thankful people can remember how God has provided in the past and even see his comforting hand in their moments of trouble. When Paul wrote the letter to Philippi, the verses I read for you this morning, do you know he wrote that from prison, possibly in Rome? He had been beaten. He had been abandoned by his friends, lost contact with his churches, and yet in the midst of all of that, he wrote this epistle, which has been called the Epistle of Joy, after going through all of that. So, my friends, you can be a thankful person by not allowing today's troubles to blind you from yesterday's blessings. You can be a thankful person by realizing also that today's troubles might actually be tomorrow's miracles. John Henry Hollett said this: gratitude is a vaccine, an antitoxin, and an antiseptic. And I believe he's right. Gratitude can be a vaccine that can prevent the invasion of a disgruntled attitude. An antitoxin, as it prevents the disastrous effects of certain poisons and diseases, such as fault finding and grumbling. And when